Welcome back to Colony, the official podcast. I'm your host, Tara Bennett, a senior producer for Sci-Fi Wire. And we have another great edition of the podcast this week for the Emerald City with the great and wonderful Ozzes of our story, co-creator and executive producer Ryan Condal.
Hello.
And the executive producer, Wes Took. Hello, sir.
Hi, I'm actually calling in from a cabin. Apparently, people are a little bit upset about last week's episode, and I'd like to apologize on behalf of my family in America.
Yeah, he's totally in witness protection. He's not in a bowl like our next guest used to be when we had him last season.
That's right.
Also, we're going to get the Bowman's perspective with Josh Holloway and Sarah Wayne Callies chiming in on this new chapter. But we have with us via phone, and I said, not in a bowl, because we're very fancy now. We have nice studios. The stallion himself, Peter Jacobson. Hello, sir.
Hello.
That was amazing.
How are you? I don't know how that comes off on an iPhone.
It sounded amazing.
Noise worked.
It was very authentic.
Did it good. All right.
Yeah,
you've been practicing. Well, it's so great to have you back. We're thrilled to be able to get into the Snyder of it all.
All right.
It is a huge episode for you, but I want to start out by going a little bit back with Ryan and Wes about essentially this episode kind of being a whole new arc for many of the characters. Even in the cold open, we meet a brand new character with Wayne Brady's Everett Kynes, who is incredibly topical to our time. So let's talk about where you guys were thinking in terms of where we need to place the characters and introducing someone that's going to be a big player for the rest of the arc.
Yeah, I mean, this is a big transition episode that takes us into what will become the rest of season three of the show. When we broke the season, the first five episodes stood out as the first act of season three. And we had envisioned an episode that would take us from that first act to the second act of the season. So this is it. This is the transition. This is the thing that connects the tissue mm-hmm. and brings Seattle into the picture. And we've been hinting at it. We've been laying the seeds for Seattle really since episode two.
Yeah.
And we get to see it pay off in a big way. And even though we don't see inside the walls just yet, we do know that this is a very different place than the colony that we're familiar with from Los Angeles.
In conception, we had seen several iterations of the Los Angeles colony and different ruling theories there. And we went into the camp, which was kind of its own colony. We got to see a different person there. So we're thinking about Everett, who's going to play a large role moving forward. And we were thinking about how you could play with those tropes in a new and interesting way.
Yeah.
And this is your first little window into him, but I think it's important that it's a character that you shouldn't make any assumptions about.
Mm-hmm.
And in Colony, we've kind of conditioned our audience to think the worst of people, but
including the writers.
Yes. And much like McGregor, this is someone who knew something before events started to occur
right.
and therefore has an inside track and was ahead of it in a way we haven't seen. And this little window into his life starting to formulate a plan. So you realize that a lot of people in the show are kind of looking at the situation right in front of their nose.
Right.
And you're running into someone who may be thinking more broadly than that.
If you go back to season one, all the way back, I mean, we've really been laying the track for this idea of this algorithm, this idea that there was a very organized method to the madness of how the population was sort of selected for and chosen even before the events of the arrival. And Snyder talked about it. And because it's Snyder, we never necessarily trust anything that he's saying. We know there's some truth to all of it, but he uses it to puff himself up or to seem like he knows things or doesn't know things at times. But this is the beginning of that coming together, and there are a lot of answers coming from that. So the whole idea of Cambridge Analytica and all that, I think people will be talking about that a lot as these episodes unfold and we see the danger of our trust of technology. But I mean, we've been fascinated with that since that architecture room we were breaking season one. We talked a lot about that and how we are all every day just putting ourselves out there on the internet and all this information about ourselves that's seemingly harmless.
Accepting all those terms without reading.
Exactly.
Yes.
But then also creating a profile for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what Cambridge Analytica did. It uses quizzes to develop personality profiles on people. We all thought this was total science fiction when we were crafting it, but then, news happens and we again realize that we are seeing into the future.
Well, in that architecture room, we spent some time thinking about, if you were going to invade the planet and try to be efficient about it and figure out ways to transition people into being a slave labor force, you would want to know as much about the human population and behavior as possible.
Yeah.
And as McGregor says early in this season, we're literally just putting it all online. You're giving it up for free.
Yep.
But you get coupons.
You do. You get coupons. We've been looking at it from the perspective of the alien, an alien invasion, but it was so obvious that we were creating a weapon that could very easily be used against ourselves
yeah.
or against democracy.
All right. So let's all never use our phones again. But otherwise, as to the Snyder of it all, Peter, let's get back a little bit to the beginning of this season and reflect on Snyder's highlight moments. He's had to swallow a lot of humble pie as the dog's body of the story so far. I'm sure your guns are big, with all of the water that you've carried and the
yep.
slave labor that you've done. when he was with the Bowmans living in that cabin, were you kind of playing him as someone who was allowing himself to connect to the Bowmans or more a man biding his time?
As I often don't know what's coming down the pike, mm-hmm. which is because Wes and Ryan don't ever say anything because really they're just not good writers to work with. No, they will tell us what we want to know pretty much as a sort of nice push-pull. I don't want it too much and they don't want to tell me too much. So I didn't know how far I was going, but I certainly got the sense, even in the first episode, obviously, that I was up to something else. Mm-hmm. So there was some kind of plan there, and Ryan and Wes were real clear there, you know, what was important to sort of show in that regard. As far as the playing of it, and it becomes apparent pretty quickly in the episode that Snyder is double dealing here, but in terms of the playing of it, Snyder instinctively knows how to play the truth of anything, and that is that he needs to be in this family and feel like he is a part of it. So as an actor, it was real easy for me to play very much that Snyder is here with this family, that it's true, it's real, he is a part of the family, he loves the kids, he has fun with the kids, and those are in some ways the funnest scenes to play, because yeah. How do you act with Jacob and Isabella and not just enjoy being, or Alex, and not just enjoy being in a very honest situation, and it's different. I don't get a lot of opportunities to act with the two younger kids, and it was just really fun. Even with Snyder, you want to come from a place of real honesty and let the writing take you to the more nefarious spots.
We try to write to what Peter can do well, so he provided us with a resume in season one yeah. and had taken this water carrying class at Juilliard, and we just thought, you know, when is the best time to deploy that?
That's right.
Finally several came times. Out. Yeah. Several times.
And don't forget my sprinting through the woods. I did get a hernia with the water stuff, which was fine, because I also took a how to act with a hernia class at Juilliard, so it all worked out well. But Ryan and Wes have been very accommodating to my special skills.
Yes. Well, the camels come in season four.
Yeah. Peter said that for some reason, writer's room seemed to delight in tormenting him after a certain amount of time, and I don't think that speaks to his personality at all. I have no idea where it comes from, but it seems to be escalating quickly on the show. We have had to employ a hair fluffer, though, for some...
Yeah. I'm yeah. game, baby. Throw anything at me. Throw me a 30-pound right. water He's, jug. Throw me a...
He does it all.
100-yard dash through the woods, and I'll do it.
Yeah.
Throw it at him. He's good. He's good. Well, let's take a moment to have Josh Holloway and Sarah Wayne Callies talk about where the Bowmans are emotionally in the wake of Charlie's death.
When we come back in 3-6 with that first scene of the bedraggled Bowmans on that road, this is not an easy show for three seasons regardless. But that is probably one of the scenes where you all look like the life has been utterly sucked from out from underneath you.
That
Best scene where I had to take the car yes. from my family was devastating.
Yes, yeah. that was...
And the rain.
And the thing is, it's always
cold by now.
It looks cold and every worst possible scenario.
It was late. We were dead. Just felt exactly
it was one of those scenes where you're like, remember when we used to shoot this in a studio lot
yeah.
in Los Angeles? And it was warm and dry and sunny. And
but I'm like, what'd you say? Oh my God. The winds coming, the rain. It was amazing.
That was tough.
Obviously, Gracie is in dire need.
Yes.
She's sick. She's got mm-hmm. this infection. So that's part of what's propelling you. So tell me about what your mindset was in terms of the Bowmans are at their last straw. What is getting them through just even walking down this road to get Gracie to be in a good place?
That's it. You
that's
know
it.
That.
That's it.
It's Gracie.
We've got two living children.
And then we have two living children.
Yeah.
And a wife in my mm-hmm. case. So it's like. Because in reality, I often thought of this with the children.
Yeah.
And if either of my children died, I really don't see me taking another step.
Right.
I may just freeze right there.
Yeah.
But this was an exploration of what the reality is. If you lose one and you have other, you have to keep going.
Yeah. yeah.
You have no choice. Yeah. Even though you may be a zombie about it and just on autopilot, you still must survive for them and be strong.
Yeah.
And I think what's really remarkable is what happens with Brown.
Yes.
You know, is that, and you'll see it continue to build throughout the season. That one gunshot that kills Charlie reverberates throughout the rest
yeah.
of the season.
Yeah.
And mm-hmm. I think this is actually one of the most interesting seasons for Brown that he's ever had, because his
yes.
development as a character and as a young man and actor is extraordinary.
It's extraordinary. And he is 19. He's standing on the precipice of life.
Yes.
He's full of energy and... I mean, I had to do a little scene with him later on where we tussle around a bit, and I'm like, whoa.
Yeah.
That's what 19-year-old strength yeah. feels like. I was yeah. like, wow.
Yeah.
When facing someone like you.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
He's strong.
you guys are an emotional through line of just trying to get to Seattle, but then there's that one moment where you guys are underneath that bridge and we get those walker drones again. And that's a hugely visceral moment where, you know, you're reacting to nothing, of course, but how you guys emotionally add that into what also you have to deal with in this episode.
Well, you know, I actually think in some ways those moments of fight or flight become a little bit of a relief,
yeah,
because it's the only break you get from the loss and the grief and the self-hatred. You know, I mean, I think, you know, you look at the statistics of parents who lose children and it's something like 98% of the marriages end in divorce. I think if there's a way forward, the way forward, and to be honest, I'm not sure that there is, but the way forward is because of things like those drones, because of the moments of having to be so present with immediate dangers.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that scene is, in a way, although we don't know it at the time, it's a bit of a pivot point of realizing that the occupation that we knew and their tactics are a totally different thing up here.
Yeah.
And, you know, what we find is that Seattle is not like LA at
yeah.
all. It's prettier, but that doesn't necessarily mean it's any less
dangerous.
Dangerous,
yeah.
I mean, it's also one of those weird moments where, like, the writers backed into something that when the Cambridge Analytica story broke,
right.
I called them up and I was like, if you knew about this ahead of time, you should have told someone.
You should have told the country.
You have a moral responsibility.
Exactly. Because it's true. Like, Ryan and Wes are time travelers. Like, that's
yeah.
the only thing that explains the three seasons of this show
yes.
that are consistently predictive with the worst aspects of American democracy
yes.
Yes.
and geopolitical. Like, it's not even American, right? Like,
yeah,
it's
everywhere.
Sort of
yeah. Exactly. Yeah, the framing of that whole episode, it's a great tip up to who knows what we're going to see next.
When it all goes down in End of the Road, which is the episode before this, that's a huge moment at the very end when we see Snyder see Charlie in that pile of bodies. And is that a life-changing moment for him? Or is that a, well, this is what happens with anybody, his daughter, any collateral damage that's going to happen, even if you mean something to somebody?
Yes, that's part of it. But Wes and Ryan were also real clear about this moment, that this is a real watershed moment for Snyder.
Mm-hmm.
Right? We actually, it was probably of the season, to me, seems like the most significant point, a real turning point for him. And then we talked a lot about it. They were very clear, and it makes a lot of sense. This is a moment where something shifts, something goes darker in him. He is very much aware, even though he would argue till the cows come home, that he did it for this reason and this reason, wound up saving the family. I don't know that he knew that's what was going to happen, but typical Snyder, I did the expedient thing in the moment, and look at how I saved this or this positive outcome. But you can't escape the fact that because of what I did, this boy is gone.
Yeah.
And the boy that I knew, and ironically, he's the one that I helped reunite with the family. So
yeah.
there's that drama in it. And where it pushes Snyder is first this place of I'm out, I'm done, I don't want to do this anymore. My interpretation was this is too much, too dark. You know, you hit a spot in Alan Snyder where he was ready to give it up. He didn't want to be in this place of this much pain and darkness anymore. That's the very moment of seeing the body.
Yeah.
He's able to sort of buck up and get to where he needs to go, which is Switzerland. But once there, sitting with this new place of I'm done, he has that moment where he sees the pictures and sort of relives that and realizes, as he says, I don't want to listen to this in my head anymore. I don't want to see these images anymore. My sense is that he just, it's like a shark. Their teeth are angled in such a way, the deeper you go, you can't get out. I think he's just at that point, he realizes there is no escape, so he's going to go even deeper and darker. And that's the transition I hope we see going forward that we talked a lot about, is there's a new level of Snyder that we haven't seen. There's a new man willing now, actually, to inflict more pain, to be that much more willing to shut out what hurts, to be that much more of a bad guy, to see it, and that there's a calmness to it now. You know, Snyder, what was fun about him in the first two seasons was here's a guy who does some pretty bad stuff, but he can do it, but you also see the anxiety around it.
Right.
And that was easy for me to play. Harder for me to play is just calm, cool, collected, bad guy. And maybe that's putting it too simply, and Wes or Ryan can comment on that, but I'm hoping that as the season progresses after this moment, we see that Snyder has hit another place where he's able to inflict damage in a way that he wouldn't have been able to earlier in the first two seasons.
Yeah.
That's a very eloquent description of the evolution of the character. And I think really interesting to hear from the perspective of the actor.
Mm-hmm.
The way we wrote the character very much falls in line with that, which is that the moment that he pulls that tarp up and sees Charlie's body, it changes him. But it changes him in a way where, as Peter said, I'm out. He goes to Switzerland, and then he tries to settle in this life of retirement, this thing that he always thought that he wanted.
Right.
And then he has to sit there surrounded by strangers who are probably worse people than even he is.
He is, yeah.
And be haunted by the voice in his head or the images or the dreams or whatever that's with him. And then the episode is really him trying to settle into retirement.
Right.
And then being unable to quiet these outside voices.
Yeah.
And then breaking bad, basically, making the hard turn. We feel like maybe he's been broken by this experience and he's pulled away from it. But then at the end, you see him make the hard turn into it where he's like, well, maybe I can be really, really good at this.
This is a moment where if he was with the Bowmans, this could be a very different Snyder. But instead, he's around all of these kind of bureaucratic weasels that use each other, chew each other up. We've got Allie Walker's Helena back again. So
yeah.
She's pushing
him. Welcome back.
Don't waste all of these perfect Machiavellian machinations. Go up the ladder.
We miss those scenes between the two of them so much.
Those are fantastic.
Yeah. Oh, they're fun.
I would briefly want to push back about the bad guy of it all just a little bit, mm-hmm. in the sense that Snyder has made accommodations in his life for, he accepted when he was proxy that he was going to do things that are not necessarily morally defensible, but they're being done in the service of a greater good. And whether that's a rationalization or not is a subject, you know, you can argue about it all
right.
day.
Right.
But in his own head, I think very clearly he's willing to accommodate more and more things. The Charlie of it all is so hard is that it's the classic a million deaths is a statistic and, you know, a single death is a tragedy.
Mm-hmm.
And he's really never had his blood as personally on his hands. There's this moment in season two where he shoots the people and they topple into a dumpster and you see that effect on him.
Right.
But he didn't really know those people. So the Charlie of it all, you know, it's a crossing of Rubicon form in the sense that he can feel the personal price of this and decides to continue forward anyway.
Right.
And if I were in his shoes, the only way that I could do that is if I simply believe that the greater good ultimately has to be served. Ultimately, those are the people who make the most monstrous decisions, are the people who are convinced that their direction is correct and are willing to make huge moral compromises for it.
And certainly Snyder preached that all the way through season one and through season two, but he gets it in a deeper place now, and it's just he has more resources and is more willing to play more fully in that sandbox. But it's not necessarily a foreign idea for him. So
I would just like to say that Wes has always been a Snyder apologist, so it's not surprising to hear him try to put more positive spin on the
which is why I'm taking Wes out to dinner.
That's right. Yeah.
Very nice. Also for writing that Snyder gets to have a little bit of a boudoir moment with somebody. You know, not only does he get a butler and a sports car, but he finally gets
a
shower and
things.
A lady.
I don't get dinner.
Get a little shirtless scene.
Wes
and,
gives him, you know, running around the wet, rainy woods. I give him, you know, Swedish hot tubs and...
That's why I love these guys. That is why I love these
ladies
guys.
From
but
Region 7.
They were like, right. But I was very clear. I said, look, no sex for Snyder, none of this stuff. I just want to stay in the woods. You know, I'm a real actor. I'm a gritty guy. And they're like, no. We really, really, we know, Peter, you don't want this, but we're gonna do it for you anyway.
Yeah.
And I said very clearly, I don't want any weapons. I don't want any firearms. No cowboy James Bond thing for me. I'm pure. But they've been hinting that they want to make me into an action hero, and that's fine.
We literally gave you an Aston Martin.
We gave you James Bond's car. I will also say that Peter has given us, over the course of three wonderful seasons, has given us a good list of top 10 spit take lines, I think. In this particular episode, I will forever treasure the, and abreast I shall keep you, line. I have seen it 100 times, and it still delights me to no end.
Yep. The Julian interactions, too. The Jeeves of it all.
Yes,
the,
loved those.
I have to warn you, Julian's been a long time since I was in love.
Well, thank you. The bottom line is continue to give me an opportunity to humiliate myself, and you'll enjoy it, because I'm good at that, and I enjoy it.
I love it. So let's take a moment to throw back to Josh and Sarah again.
When you guys are at the Seattle refugee camp, mm-hmm. and you both look at him in that room, and you say, if something happens to us, you got to take care of Gracie. And there's that moment where he just looks at both of you and goes, I don't want to do that. Because you know that you're asking him to get rid of all of his childhood.
Yep.
Literally, this has not been easy already, but that is a whole other thing of asking what he needs to do to keep the family alive. Tell me about that sequence in working with him, and then also just where you both were as a couple. You know, you just let go a little bit for the first time too, emotionally.
Yeah, that was tough.
These were hard episodes.
They were super hard, and that scene was probably one of the smallest places I've ever filmed in. Mm-hmm. It was a tiny little room. It was so camera in your face, and everything is right here, and you have to really, and you're in that place.
Yes,
you have to bring that. So that was difficult, but also, again, beautifully written. And as long as we relaxed in it, it came.
Yeah.
And Alex is always right there, isn't he?
Yes.
Yeah. You know, he's just like, you can bank on him.
And that was beautiful to see that when he said, no, I don't want, that was the child, that transition from the child and then the decision, boom, he's a man. He's already a man, but that ices it right there.
Awesome. Yay! Thanks, guys. Cheers.
We have some listener mail this week.
Oh.
Oh, yeah. So Justin, who's at McIntyre2K7, wanted to know if there is a map that shows the locations of all the colonies. So Wes and Ryan, do you guys have in the writer's room, did you sketch out or want to have that just for your own edification as well as research?
We have a list. I don't know that we've ever made a map.
We've looked at a map to put together the list.
Yes. Mm,
yes. There you go.
We have a map of the world broken into the regions.
Okay.
Yes, that I've seen.
We want to leave it open for Colony Jakarta to sort it out.
That's right.
I like that. That's good.
Want all the spinoffs to really be, you know, free to...
You don't need to pen them in with too many specifics. That's good. I totally
Colony
get that.
Easter Island.
So we also, as a follow-up, wanted to know what happened to people in the eastern U.S. since it's extremely populated. Would it be parallel or is it a story that you could get to or want to, you know, hold off until you're ready?
That'd be a wonderful story to get to in season 4, Right USA.
Mm-hmm. Renew colony. Hashtag.
Yeah. You know, there's no reason to think that there's not a bunch of colonies on the eastern seaboard. I mean, some of the most populous cities in the U.S. are there. We haven't seen them. But I think as you'll shortly see, in terms of letting your imagination run wild, not all the colonies are run the same way. So in theory, there could be a lot of very different things going on the East Coast. So stay tuned.
For this, I'd like to thank Josh Holloway and Sarah Wayne Callies, Wes and Peter Jacobson and Ryan for being our wonderful guests today.
Woo.
Thank you guys so much, and I can't wait to see what happens next.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
And thank you to my podcast team, as always, producer Bartley Taylor, producer-editor Paul Terry, mixer and master Dave Draper, who is in the UK. We're exotic, guys. And LA Digital Recording for being our home this week. If you're enjoying the show, please give us a review and subscribe on iTunes. Our rankings help with Colony's profile altogether, Renew Colony. And we want more of your questions for our listener mail segments. So leave them for me via the comments section at the bottom of every weekly podcast post on Sci-Fi Wire, or just reach out to us on Twitter. You can find me at my handle, at Tara D. Bennett, and just let me know what you'd like me to ask, and we will include it. And we can't wait to have you with us next week.